And welcome to our program, Where God Weeps, a program where we talk about the suffering church around the world. Today, we consider Egypt, a country where the latest political upheaval have created an increasing tension between the different religious communities. To learn more about the situation of Christians in Egypt, it is my privilege to welcome to our program Bishop Kyrillos William, Bishop of Assyut in Egypt. Your Excellency, welcome to our program.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Your Excellency, we see in Egypt these changes in politics, in the government. It seems that, you know, every week we're receiving news of new developments. But the situation of Christians has improved?
Really, until yet, we didn't saw any change because we was always discriminated, and still now we feel this. We didn't feel that there is a political will to change, to consider us as citizen first category like the others. But we hope in the future, because the new constitution provides the citizenship of all Egyptians, the equality and the rights of the minorities.
It's evident that probably there would be political changes, as you mentioned, even with the constitution. But nevertheless, there is some animosity in the culture against Christianity. And we're going to show a video about one of these very difficult situations that the Christian community is facing in Egypt. And it's the tragedy about these young girls being kidnapped into forced marriages and at the same time into conversion to Islam. So we're gonna see now this video titled The Kidnapped Brides. And after the video, we'll come back to talk about it with Bishop Kyrillos.
We want to know the whereabouts of our daughters. Our daughters are 14, 16, 15 years old. Where are they? Who has taken them away from us? What is happening with them? I want to talk with my daughter. I want to hear her voice, to find out whether she is alive or not. I want nothing more. I want to hear my daughter's voice.
Egypt is most often associated with ancient history, pharaonic dynasties, the pyramids, and tourism. Few holidaymakers to Egypt notice what lies concealed behind the facade of this ancient paradise. In 2011, acts of terror against Christians, which make up a mere 15% of the total population of 80 million, escalated. Perhaps the most horrific and hidden aspect of contemporary Christian persecution is the abduction and forced conversion of underage girls.
Instances of forceful conversions to Islam have been prevalent in Egypt since the beginning of the 1990s, ever since Islamic and Sharia groups began to spring up. These incidents took place under the patronage of the National Security Agency. After the revolution and the disbanding of the agency, Salafists began acting in accordance with their own aims. After the revolution, we noticed how their interest turned towards 11, 12, and 13-year-olds. There is a whole group of girls this age who have totally disappeared.
One of such abducted Egyptian Christian girls is 14-year-old Nadia Saeed Makram, who vanished while visiting a church.
I led her to church. When the church service began, I went outside for a moment. On my return, Nadia was gone. We went outside and searched the streets. Then we came back to church, but she was nowhere to be seen. And then they suddenly told me, "Your daughter has been kidnapped." I was shocked when I learned that my sister had been kidnapped. We turned the world upside down. With our friends, also Christian, from work. We ran left and right. We searched in all sorts of places, in hospitals. We were well shocked. We later found out that they had kidnapped her because she was a Christian.
Kidnappings are tragically increasingly the order of the day in Egypt. Young Christian girls are taken away to unknown destinations where they suffer multiple rape, are drugged, and then after a few weeks of torture, coerced and blackmailed to convert to Islam.
If a young Christian girl disappears in Egypt today, then it is more than likely that in a month or two she will appear in a video clip, admitting that she has become a Muslim of her own free will. The moment she makes such a declaration, she officially becomes a Muslim, and her Christian family lose all rights to her.
It is alleged by local Christians that not only do the local Muslim authorities do nothing to protect these young women, but often tacitly accept these kidnappings as part of a larger regional call to Islam.
These acts are also financed by Islamic backers from outside Egypt. A young girl fetches from 20 to 100,000 Egyptian pounds, depending on her looks and social standing.
Though the detention sites where the young Christian girls are imprisoned are sometimes known, the local police are silent in face of these crimes. Nadia Saeed's parents have, from the day of her kidnapping, unsuccessfully demanded that the Egyptian police act to uncover the perpetrators of the crime. The drama is all the more poignant as the whereabouts of the 40-year-old male behind their daughter's kidnapping is well known.
I went to report the kidnapping to the public prosecutor's office. The police came to my house and roughed us up and searched our home. I was forced to leave because the chief prosecutor quite literally told me, "We will finish you off." I should have stayed put and quiet. Though I know the kidnapper, I should nevertheless not level any charges, but quite simply accept a missing persons inquiry. I must accept my daughter's kidnapping or leave.
I talked with a certain Christian from Egypt who told me that they often know where such girls are kept, but are incapable of doing anything about it. The only thing that remains for them to do is to walk around such a house and pray.
The kidnapping of young Christian girls and their forceful conversion to Islam leads to a number of other dramatic consequences. In the light of Egypt's new constitution, inspired by Sharia law, reversion to Christianity following a conversion to Islam, freely or by coercion, is practically impossible. The most extreme punishment for apostasy from Islam is death.
As relates to the return of people to Christianity, we have lodged 5,000 petitions for the single purpose of regaining a Christian's right to return to Christianity. Of course, such acts are not bereft of problems, difficulties, and the harassment by fanatics when they find out that, having converted to Islam, they now want to return to Christianity.
Terrified young Christian girls, harassed and exposed to Muslim provocations, find some help in church centers, such as the one operating in the Catholic Archbishopric of El Minya. Apart from material assistance, they, above all else, receive spiritual and psychological support.
We try to talk with the girls about any problem that might have occurred, attacks, rape. We try to convince them to stay here for a while, to recuperate, and thus enable them to become valuable members of society anew. A girl comes here to be rehabilitated and can stay here from 6 months to a year, even more than a year. We then give her a curator, and this curator, even when she leaves, never leaves her. When a girl comes here, she doesn't pay for anything. The bishopric takes responsibility for everything about her, whether her beliefs, her life, as well as all health and social matters.
There was a group of Muslims set on kidnapping me. That is why I am here. There were problems between the group of Muslims and my brother. They feared for my safety, and so they put me here. Now when I have free time, I can't go home because of them, because I am scared of them, their stare. So when I am home, I always stay inside and never ever go outside. If I stay here for another year, I will get married and not go back home to live there. I will immediately wed.
In addition to kidnappings and forced conversions, young Christian girls are forced to cover their heads and faces according to Muslim tradition or bear humiliation. Despite the escalating nature of these crimes, a veil of silence in the international community has rendered this subject mute.
Christians essentially realize that under the present circumstances, unless the free world, the West, wakes up and does something to effectively help them, to influence the Egyptian authorities to change their policy towards Christians, essentially a policy of consent to victimization and a brutal showdown with Christianity, then all that is left to them is their faith in God and prayer.
This is a photograph of when she was very small. This is a picture from when she was taking her grammar school entrance exam. This is a picture of Nadia with her father and siblings. This is a picture of Nadia. This is a picture of Nadia.
Welcome back to our program with Bishop Kyrillos from Assyut in Egypt. It is very impressive, Your Excellency, to see this suffering of these families that they have lost their daughters. And it's really such indifference from the authorities.
We observe really that it is a very, very tragic situation of those families, and they seek help and they didn't found by the authorities. How it comes, we think that the authorities are involved in this matter because they know where are the girls, but they didn't move to deliver them.
And in some occasions, the family is even harassed and threatened that some other bad things could happen to them if they continue with their investigation.
Yes. It happens with girls. It happens now a day with many adults, kids, and businessmen, cops, who kidnapped for money ransom. And they go to police, and the police tell them, you have to pay the money to save the life of your beloved ones. Then we can catch them and give you the money again, but never.
But that sounds almost like extortion.
Yes.
Now, is this the reality in the whole country, Your Excellency, or it's in particular regions?
We can say in the whole country, but in more and more in the Upper Egypt, in the villages, in the area of Minya, Assyut sometimes, Sohag, and Kena.
Your region in Assyut has been the scenario for some of the most violent attacks. Do you live in constant fear, Your Excellency, of something could happen again?
No, really. We have a big confidence in the providence, and we try to deal with our brother, non-Christians, and to find ways to collaborate together and to live peacefully with them. And at the end, we know that God will not deliver us to them. The protection of God is very, very strong, and our people are faithful and full of hope. And somebody is afraid, okay, afraid, but the majority, we don't fear.
Recently, several members of the Muslim Brotherhood, they were sentenced to death penalty. Do you think that this might be a catalyst for more violence?
It can be. It can be, yes, more violence. They promised this. But this sentence at the beginning was for 600 people. But it was just an opinion from the judge. It should be approved by the highest authority of the Mufti. And the Mufti reduced this number to 39 cases. And it can cause some trouble.
And what are the expectations in terms of politics? Do you think that Christians should get involved more as a political party, or how can they guarantee what you just mentioned at the beginning of being considered first-class citizens and not just a second-class?
Yes, we try to encourage our faithful to participate, to take part, active part in the civil life, of all day life. Take part in some party, political party, but we don't want to have a Christian party because we are against the parties of basis of
religion identity,
yes. And there are many, many Christians now in many parties, liberal parties, and The big number of the Christians we show it on the 30th of June, how many Christians were and many Muslim fundamentalist Muslim Brotherhood members are thinking that the Copts are the cause of the end of their regime. The Copts are not a few. And when they take part, active part in the election, in the social life, they can change many things, yes.
Now, what is the percentage nowadays of Coptics in Egypt?
The official statistics speaks about 10 million, but they are more.
So it's more
between
than 10.
15 and 20 millions, yeah. Also, some Muslim said that this clearly that the Copts are not less than 23 millions who live in Egypt and in the diaspora also together.
Is the Coptic community facing an exodus? Are they migrating out of fear?
More than the in the past, some Copts, but also some Muslims are looking for exodus, to seek a better life, to seek more security, more liberty, but more Christian in the last time than in the past. Yeah.
Your Excellency, I think it was very impressive for the international community to see in some of these attacks a human chain of Muslim people defending some of the churches that had been attacked. That was very, very impressive. What is the meaning of this, Your Excellency, in the sense of this is the reality that some of the Muslims really want to live in harmony?
The majority of the Muslim want
to live. It is a majority.
The majority of the Muslim want to live in harmony with the other Egyptians, and they are refusing what the fundamentalist Islamists are doing. And in many villages in my diocese, the parish priest told me that the Muslim came and defend the church and spent all the night on the church until the parish priest, don't worry anything, we are here, you can go to sleep. We cannot accept that somebody come and disturb you. They came and surrounded the church with people defending.
And my last question, because unfortunately we're running out of time, Your Excellency, do you feel that the international community is aware of the challenges of Christians in Egypt? Do you think that we know exactly what's going on?
Not enough. And what we are trying to tell them about the challenges, to the church, you need to organize a meeting in the Brussels with many responsible, and a delegation for our church was with me, another bishop and a layman, a lady. And we met Miss Ashton, we met Van Rompuy, we met many responsible at the EU to explain to them, because our Muslim brothers very, very strong in propaganda, in the media, and they diffused their ideas. But we had also to introduce our ideas also and our vision, and the vision of many Muslim, moderate Muslims also.
Well, Your Excellency, we really want to thank you for this opportunity to spend this time with us. And you know that the prayers of our audience are always with your community.
We need your prayers, your encouragement, and we are thanking you for all that you do for us, to encourage us to remain, to stay in our countries.
Thank you, Your Excellency. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being with us in our program of Where God Weeps. If you want to learn more about the situation of the church in Egypt or in other parts of the world where the church is suffering, please contact the information at the end of this program. Thank you, and God bless.